I'm Vicky Blight for Absolute 80s backstage at Let's Rock the Moor in Cookham. It's really super sunny, the weather's warm, and we're joined by Roland Gift, lead singer of Fine Young Cannibals. You're probably, what, about 45 minutes, an hour off going on stage?
Yeah, close to that.
How is the preparation these days? Is it very relaxed? Are you more relaxed now than you were, say, at the height of the Raw and the Cooked in 1989?
No, not really.
No,
I mean, just as much can go wrong or right. But usually, sort of half an hour before, I like to get into my place and do the things that I usually do, the routines.
Are we allowed to know about the routines, or are they top secret?
They're just a little bit quirky, so I'd rather not share them.
Because we'll
you might start thinking certain things about me that aren't true. So.
I saw a load of stuff being wheeled into your dressing room in suitcases, so I'm going to leave it there. I'm not going to ask. Going right back, we're celebrating the 80s, and I'm guessing you spent the majority of the 80s in Birmingham.
No, not so, actually.
Okay.
I mean, the group was based in Birmingham, and I used to commute from London to, we'd rehearse and write. But I think by about 87, the group then was based in Birmingham, based in London.
Kind of all collaborated and formed. In terms of cities, and looking at Birmingham and looking at London and how they were in the 80s to how they are now in 2015, how do you think both of those places have changed?
I think it's a lot easier to get a decent meal in London.
British food did come on significantly in the last 25, 30 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's probably the biggest difference, that you can get more than a bag of chips or a kebab now. Mm-hmm. Harder to say with Birmingham. I'm not so familiar. I haven't been going back to Birmingham as much as I used to.
But
I think, you know, generally people are expecting a little bit more than a warm pint and a stale pie.
Or a half-open packet of crisps.
Yeah.
In terms of venues as well, I mean, there are so many smaller venues that are closing down all over the country.
Yeah.
What are some of your sort of favourite hotspots, as were back in the 80s when you were starting out and Fine Young Cannibals had formed?
The Tin Can, that was in Birmingham. That was a really, really great venue. Lots of plush seats and curtains. That was a really good one. I used to live in Hull, and the Silhouette Club was great. That was a fantastic place. And the Welly, which is still going, actually. That's a music venue up there that's still going. In London, used to be this place in Covent Garden called the Rock Garden. And that was played there years and years ago. I played there in one of the first groups I was in. I mean, places close because people stop going.
Yeah.
So, if people want to go, then a place will stay open. So it's a little bit sad, but it's not like you can't keep a place open if nobody's going to go there.
Yeah, everything's a business, I guess. But do you think in some ways that festivals help support live music, in terms of if people can go to one event and see a whole load of artists on a bill and get a flavour for each of them, and would that encourage them maybe to go to more gigs and to kind of re-energise the music scene?
Possibly, yeah. I mean, yeah, because there'll be people here that will see me because they like the Cannibals, but then there'll be some who'll hear the new stuff and think, oh, well, that's interesting, you know, maybe I'll go see a longer set. So it would never harm.
It was sort of two albums for the Cannibals, and then things went very quiet and you became a dad and you took some time out. What made you kind of get back into the, not just singing, but also you were writing as well, weren't you? Kind of re-engaged you into the,
well,
into
the, I'd never sort of really stopped, but I think I don't know, you sort of, if you do something me personally, if I do something all the time, it becomes a little, it doesn't suit my personality. I like to do sort of different things. So it's quite good not playing too much, because then it feels more eventful when I do.
You've been touring with Jules Holland's band.
Yeah.
Let's in on a few secrets. I mean, that's a massive production in itself. What is it like being on that tour and going around with that sort of full entourage?
If I let you in on the secret, it wouldn't be a secret anymore. So that's clearly not going to happen.
Is there an incredible vibe to those tours, though?
Oh yeah, no, it's great. I mean, it is a very well-oiled machine. You know, they've been doing it a good while. But it's, yeah, everybody's really, really friendly. I mean, that was the thing, because there's quite a lot of them. The band is, it's a big group of people.
It's a big band, yeah.
Yeah. And, but yeah, everybody was really, really, just the whole tone of the place is just very, very friendly.
And Jules has a great habit of continuing to spot new talent and to bring kind of lesser known artists as well onto his stage to duet with him and various things. How do you keep your sort of finger on the pulse in terms of new musicians and new writers and new artists? Is that something you actively do?
Not yes and no. I mean, if I hear about it, I mean, just, you know, word of mouth probably more than anything. But I'm quite happy. You know, it's really word of mouth.
I mean, if someone tips you off, then you think you've really got to go and see this guy or this girl.
Or you see something on TV, like on Later, or any program that shows people that aren't necessarily as well known. But yeah, I mean, usually if something's interesting, you'll hear about it.
Yeah. So when you go on stage, we're expecting the whole audience to be, you know, singing your lyrics right back at you for a good thing. And that was used in a TV advert not so long ago. It's a song that remains ever present, a huge radio hit. It still gets huge radio airplay as well. How difficult is it now to write a hit song where so many artists and musicians are just uploading everything onto the internet? Is it harder to find those hits, or possibly do they pop out even stronger?
Well, Good Thing wasn't a hit when it was first written, so it's only you know, people make a hit. You know, you write a song, but people make a hit. It's different now because, you know, a few years ago there was Top of the Pops, so people recognised that as the marker for if something was a hit.
Sort of a seal of approval.
Yeah. So it is a little bit. It's harder to know now. It's, you know, the number one doesn't always carry the same weight that it did before.
And I guess you don't have to sell as many records now to get to that position. So plans for the rest of the summer and for the rest of 2015, what are you up to? Where can we catch you?
Well, some more shows. I'm doing Bristol, Grassingham, Milton Keynes, London on the 3rd of July at the Jazz Cafe. And then I've written this musical called Return to Vegas. And so some of the new songs that we'll be doing today are in this musical. So I'll be getting that off the ground as well.
Okay. And in terms of the story running through that, what's the theme that's going to link that all together?
I'll give the elevator pitch.
Please.
All right. Johnny Holloway, ex-boxer, ex-pop star, ex-con, is released from prison in time for the funeral of his friend and mentor, Frank Wheeler. At the wake, Johnny finds that he's inherited Frank's club, the Welly, along with Ricky, Frank's only son. Johnny doesn't plan to stay. Ricky wants him dead, whichever way. What will save Johnny? The dirty money, the funny girl, or the sad song? Return to Vegas, based on a true story that didn't happen.
Wow. I can't wait. Well, best of luck with that.
Thank you.
Enjoy your set today. I know we will.
Cheers.
It's Roland Gift here for Absolute 80s at Let's Rock Them All.